guys, where the hell did you queens come from?
I was thinking after I wrote my Big Fat Greek Wedding, what else would I like to play? So I thought, well, it'd be really fun to sing and dance in something. So I started writing about these two girls from Chicago and horrible things happen to them and ha ha ha. And then they witness a murder and they get to Los Angeles. And what I had was that they were just dinner theater performers. So I had that they get fired from the job, they get evicted from their apartment, and then they go to a bar and they think things are looking up because they're dancing with two guys. And then the two guys kiss. Ha ha ha, thinking that's funny. What else can go wrong for these two poor girls? And then I went, wait a minute. And I just thought, wouldn't it be funny if a drag show started? And wouldn't it be funny if these two girls wanted to be in this show? And then I went, oh! And I went back to the beginning and I just completely changed the concept. And I didn't set out to write a drag queen movie. It's like it knocked on my door and found me.
When I first read Connie and Carla, it appealed to virtually my entire history, musically and theatrically speaking. I was raised in a theatrical family. My dad did many Broadway shows and television series and movies and stuff. And from the time I was 7 years old, he began taking me to the theater, and my appreciation for theater and musicals in particular could not have been more elevated by the time I had read this script.
I knew Michael Lembeck from before. I had about four lines on a TV series called Two Guys and a Girl, and Michael was the in-house director of that show. And he was so nice to me that when his name came up about directing this movie, I was thrilled to go in and sit down with him. And then I found out he's a big musical theater geek. He knows it all, and this is the guy for this movie.
So I read this script, and not only did it have this wonderful story, but it had 31 musical cues in it. I thought, oh my goodness, this is too good to be true.
Oh my God, we're in! Oh, Carla, we're in!
Okay. I find Nia the most affable, accessible, joyous person I've ever collaborated with. She's so much fun.
This is my director, Michael Lembeck.
Hello.
He's now my best friend. You know why? Makes me pretty.
I know this sounds like, you know, I'm doing an interview and I'm trying to say nice things about the star, but the fact of the matter is, I've had such a great time with her. I've worked with some of the most wonderful writers and actor writers that television has ever produced. And this is as joyous and fun a relationship and a working situation as I have ever had. I would take her with me wherever I went if I could.
As the camera,
I came up like your point of view and just stop right
thing.
Here.
Oh, that's great.
So this is you guys, and what'll happen is when he kills him, it goes bang, pop up here.
Bonnie and Carla, duck, bang.
Oh, cool. Do that Russian accent again.
Bonnie and Carla.
Bonnie and Carla.
The cast came together basically like all things do. Certain of the leading roles are offered to the players. Certain of the leading/supporting roles are either offered or auditioned. And the rest comes from the inspiration of the people around the movie.
I just love Toni Collette. Every actress wants to work with her because she's a broad, you know? She's not too girly and she's not too tough. She's just this great woman.
My agent told me about the script and kind of gave me a few clues as to what was involved, and immediately I was like, I want to read it. And he said it was not the final draft, it was still being worked on, and I was like, I don't care, I gotta read it.
Oh, sorry, the show is actually over.
If you're flying through, come back in a month when the show will be huge.
Huge!
We're Connie.
And Carla.
Do you like musicals?
Stop talking, strange women.
Everyone loves to sing, and dinner theater is a part of American life far too undervalued if you ask.
Cut, please.
God, that's still you guys. Man, that is the way to do that.
I remember how things changed because in My Big Fat Greek Wedding, we practically had to beg people to do it. And with this movie, they said, who would you like for Carla? And I was like, what I like, do you think we could get Toni Collette? And suddenly it was done.
Toni Collette used to be cool. She had quite the distinguished career. Oscar nominee. It ends here. We're wearing a tablecloth.
I consider Toni one of the 5 or 10 best actors working in the world. And when I found out that she wanted to do this and her background is musical theater, it's just every day I just count my blessings. I can't believe I get to do what I do and to be blessed with somebody like Toni in our company of actors is it's a gift.
I have David Duchovny on the phone. Everybody say hello.
We got David Duchovny to play my boyfriend. I don't know if he owed people money. I don't know what happened, but he wanted this part and we said, yes, please.
I'd known Michael Lembeck for a while, and I just got a call from my agent to read the script and to meet Michael, and then just from there, it was pretty smooth. I liked the script a lot, and I like Michael, and it was an easy decision.
I had seen a lot of wonderful actors for the part of Jeff, and hadn't quite yet found the one, and you don't want to compromise on this part. I invited him to screen test with Nia, the old-fashioned screen test, and he accepted, and they were wonderful together. It was the first actor she had real, wonderful, genuine chemistry with. And he walked out of the room, and Nia and I were just jumping for joy because we knew we had our guy.
Connie, I've never seen you out of drag, but as a broad, you're a real looker.
Oh.
Can I get one more of, would you like?
What I wrote in the script is A-C-K, ACK. That's all. So, and it's not any comment on male-on-male kissing, it's just that Jeff enjoys kissing females, that's all. And he thinks that I'm a boy, and so when I kiss him, and he's been doing various variations on the word ACK, and it's taking everything in my power to not laugh.
What new car is going to want to know is what's it like to kiss Toni?
Well, actually, we slept together, so we got the kissing out of the way about a month ago. That's how we got the part.
Without any question, the most challenging, the most daunting element of making this movie was the lack of days in which to do the enormous amount of material we have.
Usually in the theater, you rehearse for 6 weeks. And then you go into the theater and you tech for 3.5 weeks, then you go into previews for 3.5 weeks, and then you open. Then the show was frozen. We got 2 weeks of rehearsal with the actors, so it was really fast.
I think Chicago had like 3 or 4 months rehearsal and prep and to get all that stuff ready. We had 2 weeks. This is 31 musical cues and over 100 pages of dialogue. So that was frightening. You know, looking at a 44-day shooting schedule for something this huge.
We'd schedule everything to the minute. I remember the second day of rehearsal we had scheduled, we had the Shake Your Groove thing, boys, in the morning. And then after lunch, I had little Connie and little Carla. So I said, okay, we're doing drag queen stuff, and now we're doing Oklahoma. You know, on Brittany and Danielle. And I went, what movie is this?
Connie and Carla are not bad singers. They are a bit cheesy and naive in their taste level. So we had to think simple in that respect.
Nia had written in the script, she said, they're good, but ooh, are they cheesy? And I remember that was on the first page, and I said, well, we have to start somewhere. So it started with Oklahoma, and then it went to Yentl, and then it went to Jesus Christ Superstar, and then it went to Cats.
Ah! We tried so hard!
I consider Connie and Carla's act as the movie begins to be the cheesiest act in America, if not the world, if not of all time. Their costumes are made out of tablecloths and straw hats, and they underdress 3 and 4 outfits at a time, and each one of them is a little tackier than the one before it. Their good idea of a great cabaret act is to do just 2 or 4 lines of lyrics from each song and move on. their snappy patter between songs is very much historical. It's about who they are and where they came from. It's not necessarily funny. They're so sincere. It's just you can't believe how cheesy these two are.
We're Connie.
And Carla. Yentl is especially special to us because we know what it's like to pursue your dream. And we both lost our fathers.
They died in a baking accident.
Could I get my drink?
When I was writing the script, I thought, oh my God, I have an opportunity to sing any song I've ever wanted. So I just picked every song I've ever wanted to sing and wrote it into the movie.
You know, when you read the script, it feels like, well, people talking and there's a couple of musical numbers. Well, in order to even get to your first day of shooting, you have to choose the material, you have to secure the rights, you have to pick keys, pick harmonies, pick who sings what when. Then you go in and rehearse that. Then you pre-record it. Then you rehearse the choreography to the pre-recorded music. Then you can film your first frame. So without being able to line up all those ducks in a row, you can't do anything anyway. Then you only have 44 days to do it. Well, if I have, let's say, 23 numbers, full-out numbers to do, that leaves me 22 days to do 105 pages of dialogue. So upon very close examination of all that, there were times before I started where I would think, what am I doing? What was I thinking? Why didn't I say, guys, you can't do this? The fact of the matter is, it was really, really daunting.
The next cue is Let Me Entertain You. You want to hold it for the boys?
I don't know. I think we could...
We're pretty... Michael, some things happen while you're out of town. Right?
I think you're ready to do some stuff.
Climb.
Let me hear.
All right.
Let me hear.
Standing.
Oh, I gotta stand for this.
All right.
Nia is a natural. In other words, you either have musicality or you don't. Musicality is you've got music in your soul. So if you have that quality, you can improve on your voice. Now, I know people who have decent singing voices. They can hit notes, but they don't have musicality, and you can't teach that. So Nia had that to begin with. And she's like a sponge. She's just, she's a great student. Tony had been on Broadway in The Wild Party, which I saw. And she's also grown up in the musical theater.
I started singing when I was about 13. I kind of got into acting through doing musicals, but I never really had any training. I kind of learn with every musical director that I work with. So, yeah, still learning.
I've always liked to sing. I did summer stock and everything, so that was like no problem. I just thought, if I'm flat, they'll tell me. But the dancing, it's one thing you can't fake. So I just practiced every day. We have our choreographer, Cynthia Rubia, and her assistant, Harrison, and they just come to my trailer, knock, knock, knock. Hello, dance rehearsal.
Hey, everybody, like that?
Yes. Yeah.
But if she's gonna do this, then talk with the judge. Top of the grind. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. And so Carla takes off. Yes.
My mom's gonna see this.
I've never laughed so much in my life. Really.
Nia is very, very funny, but genuine. She knows her strengths. She knows her weaknesses, and she's willing to try anything.
Boy, that's great, you guys. That's just great. Look how tired they are. Are you all right, Alec?
Yeah.
Are you okay?
If you read a good script, you can see how to photograph it, and you can with this. And the look is totally dictated by these girls being boys. You know, how do you photograph the girls that are supposed to obviously look like boys, but we have to take a slight judgment on that because we always know that they're girls, but still you have to make them not look ugly. They still have to be pretty as boys. And that's one of the things you have to constantly bear in mind, that even though they're men, apparently you have to like them as girls. The other thing that I'm always very keen on a human kind of level with a film like this is that you do believe you are where you are. And I try not to light too theatrically, though of course this particular set does give me some opportunity in that way.
When we began to think about the design of the handlebar, we basically, particularly our production designer, Jasna Stefanovic, and myself, went to many drag clubs and other clubs here in Vancouver to get a sense of what clubs look like today, particularly the ones that are a little more down.
Michael and I and Richard, we went and did our research. What do you do if you're going to do a film about drag queens? You go where the drag queens are. And we absorbed the atmosphere, the places that they hung out, that they did their performances. The toughest part was finding the exterior handlebar, which is our drab little club that is supposed to be in LA. Look at this. I mean, this is not very exciting. In fact, it is so boring. So, but that's where the art department comes in. We have to do something to make it more exciting.
Yasna came up with a sensational design for this club, which felt like something that could really feel down, not elegant, not a La Cage aux Folles place, but a real beer bar kind of place, which has now changed with the times and has disco night and drag night and this kind of thing, and will ultimately transform into a dinner theater and look elegant within the confines of the same four walls.
We're covering this whole thing with wall that's going right across in here, and of course doing signs and doors like this, and we're painting the thing pink. Pink, which is the color of LA. Of course you have to have it pink. And then this side here, it's very drab. This serves as the lobby and the entrance of the girls' apartment, which is right around the corner from where the handlebar is. We got this area partially because it worked for us in terms of geography, mostly because it worked for us in terms of being able to have almost like a back lot, complete control over the streets, because we were here for days and days and nights and nights.
Richard, our cinematographer, and Yasna, our production designer, and myself sat down and went through what the bar should look like each next time we're in there. Sconces change, the bar gets cleaner, nicer things come out, chairs change, tablecloths are added, and we very, very carefully plotted out what are the subtle, subliminal changes that happen every time we're in there, so we feel like the girl's presence in the club is impacting its context.
And then Connie and Carl have this great idea. Why don't we make it into a dinner theater? They start knocking walls down. Well, this whole thing comes off. So we take this right out. All of a sudden, there's this, the place becomes larger, and we put tables everywhere. There's symmetry, and this place becomes jam-packed, and that's the progression of the film, turning this drab little place that drag queens hang out and sort of lip sync into a really legitimate place that is actually a dinner theater where the drag queens themselves, even their performances, get lifted a notch through Connie and Carla.
Here's where we're at today. The dinner theater is here, so my personal dream has come alive that dinner theater is actually a reality in this movie. And I do truly believe that dinner theater can change the way Americans view life. Because where else can you get dinner and a show? Park the car once. It's the perfect, perfect night for the price-conscious consumer.
One of the most important relationships in the movie is the very symbiotic, synergistic relationship between production design, hair design, makeup design, costume design, and lighting design. Every one of those has to work in concert because they all change together. They all experience a qualitative heightening as the movie progresses.
You see, there's a big difference in her lips and Tony's lips, and that's what I was talking about before.
This is also a little summer version from before.
Yeah, but you know what? I think Tony's lips, as they're carved out, make it more feminine than this blockier lip. I think that carved out lip becomes too feminine, and this blocked lip is better for us.
In the context of the film, they have found perfect disguises. It gets more and more difficult to hide themselves from their drag queen friends, because anything that lying around the apartment they live in that smacks of women live here, they have to be very careful of. They have to keep their voices lower all the time. They have to be in drag all the time. So I think for the sake of our movie, yes, they have found a perfect disguise.
I do believe this is every costume designer's dream film. There are a lot of alterations in designing costumes for men playing women. And one of the problems with the girls that I'm just beginning to come to grips with is that those need to be incorporated in their costumes in some way, so that to make it more convincing for them. It's taken us a little time to really realize how to do that, and in fact, I've just had that today with one of Tony's costumes, which I fitted weeks ago. It looks lovely, but I put on today and realized that we'd done some much cleverer things since the original fitting. It's very much a work in progress, this.
It's like playing dress up. It's like being your own Barbie doll, this shoot. We get to wear all sorts of different costumes and high shoes, and I haven't breathed since Tuesday.
We're very, very lucky that the makeup and costume people have been so enthusiastic and so well educated about this subject matter. Drag is not something that they teach most costume designers and makeup artists when they go to school or to learn, and it requires the makeup people and the costume people stretching their imaginations and doing their homework, because drag is an art form of itself.
You know, given a normal show where you're doing a corrective makeup, you know, you have somebody in the chair with a man, for example, anywhere from 10 to 20 minutes, I would guess, is an average. And on this show, I think you're looking at, once we get into some of those big looks, you know, you're looking at an hour and a half. Some of them are absolutely spectacular. And Tony and Nia, on the other hand, you know, you're looking at a normal corrective beautified makeup for a woman on a film you could probably do in a half an hour to 45 minutes on an average. And here we're going anywhere from an hour to an hour and a half, an hour and 45 minutes, depending on, you know, the extent of the look if we're doing a drag or a show drag. The show drag looks are amazing because we've got huge wigs that are added on top of the makeup that take their time. You've got fantastic costumes, you've got body makeup, we've got glitter and sparkles.
There's some different looks they're doing in makeup, so how long we're in there really does depend. There's scenes when we're in the club milling around and we haven't done a show, so where it's a little more played down. And then there's the big drag sequences when we're doing the numbers all together, which is really, really heavy show makeup.
You know, Robert left home when he was just 16.
Brian!
Well, I'm glad I don't have a straight brother.
Now, we mustn't be prejudiced. Straights are people, too.
Fairly obviously, the underlying themes of the movie are just about acceptance and tolerance. And again, my character standing in for, you know, the bulk of society has a judgmental point of view towards homosexuals in general, drag queens in particular. So, you know, the journey that Jeff makes, my character, is kind of one that stands in for the audience, you would hope, to go from, you know, lack of understanding and a critical outlook to understanding and acceptance and even love towards the end.
All the way through the movie, it's those conflicts are constantly arising, people trying to be who they really are and coming up against communities that don't allow them to be that, and finding the place where all is well, where they can be both who they are and among a group of people that believe in each other.
I believe with comedy that you can make the audience laugh, but there has to be a rest period. There has to be a moment of poignancy where they kind of take it in and they take a moment and they absorb it and then they move on to the next moments of comedy. And in the poignancy, you can actually, you can kind of slide the message in without kind of banging the audience over the head. And the message really is about acceptance of the other. We're not the same. None of us, any of us, are the same. And I'm not saying that the world would be better if we were the same, but it might be better if we just go, you're different than me, that's okay.
I find myself tearing up sometimes. I walked into a rehearsal the other day where the guys were, you know, performing Mame with Debbie Reynolds, and it has such a positive message, which I guess does, you know, the pinnacle of it is right here at the end, which is what we're shooting tonight. Basically, it's that, you know, you're okay being you. You don't have to be anything but you.
We have had to hide and pretend to be something we're not. Look, we're women.
What? No.
No, you don't get it. We're women.
No.
No. Cut!
Cut?
It feels fantastic to, after 2 weeks of singing rehearsal, 2 weeks of pre-record, 2 weeks of dance rehearsal. We're here, finally, we've arrived, and it's so exciting. It's so exciting. We're in this fantastic club that our production designer had created, and our two amazing, you know, stars, Nia and Tony, are singing their asses off. And they look great, and it's just so exciting to be in here, and it really inspires me to photograph them in very dramatic fashion and really enhance the emotional content of the songs they're singing.
I thought something was up.
Me too.
No, you didn't.
Girls.
In an art form based on being true to one's real self, welcome to your outing.
The story itself, thematically, had so many ideas that appealed to me in terms of storytelling, substantial issues. You know, under the heading of, you don't have to compromise to realize your dreams, I just found that so appealing. It's so universal. People compromise who they are all the time in order to achieve some form of success or to acquire their dream or whatever that cliche would be. And in fact, this movie says you don't have to. You can be who you are and still get to the same place.